Now, I would like to warmly invite our next guest on this stage, Procter & Gamble, to bring us this wonderful speech. Bao jie, da jia, huai yin.
大家晚上好，我是宝洁传播仪公关的徐友杰，欢迎大家来到2017年金投赏宝洁的专场。今年是金投赏的10周岁生日，我们在这里呢想感谢金投赏给我们这个行业创造这么好的一个平台，让每天都能够激发自己，把我们的创意的那个水平一直拉高。今年呢，因为是金投赏10周年，为了表达我们对金投赏的感谢和支持。 我们全球首席品牌官就是毕瑞哲先生亲自到场为大家演讲。毕瑞哲先生在我们这个位置呢已经有9年的时间了，他这9年来一直在强调，只有创意才能打造优质的品牌，只有创意才能推动生意的成长。他从2016年1月开始呢，也不断的在推动我，并且提升我们 媒体透明化，而且呢，他也在强调，只有透过我们跨界的合作和专注，才能创造一个更优质、更那个连接的一个媒体供应链。今天呢，他将给我们带来一个演讲，叫做《变革的觉醒》，请大家以热烈的欢迎，掌声欢迎我们的首席品牌官 毕瑞哲 先生, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Procter & Gamble Chief Brand Officer, Mr. Marc Pritchard.
Hello, everybody. I'd like to show you some ads. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Ni hao. What you've just seen are two of our favorite ads from P&G this year. And what they reflect is our quest to achieve the highest levels of creativity and to transform our brands and our company to another level. We're transforming because the marketing world got a big wake-up call in this last year. The reason why is because digital media turned 21 years old, and we're now spending $200 billion in digital media, and it's continuing to disrupt the media industry around the world. But leadership brings big responsibility, and when we raised the bar on transparency, it became very clear that digital media had some growing pains to work through, and that it's high time for big innovation. And while digital media matured, Moore's law of doubling computing power every 18 months roared along, and the next rumblings of the next wave of digital transformation and disruption began to grow louder. Wherever you turn, massive databases are forming with unique consumer identification data. Artificial intelligence is accelerating how brands connect with consumers. And at last, the powerful dream of mass one-to-one marketing is starting to become a reality. But also, as the world became more troubled with environmental and social and political upheaval, it was brands and companies who stepped up to be responsible global citizens. Brands are fueling a new era of corporate global citizenship. They're shining the light on truth and using their voices for good. Now, we've heard these wake-up calls loudly and clearly at P&G. In fact, we are a profoundly different company than we were just a few years ago, transforming ourselves for a world of ongoing disruption. Our ambition is to be the absolute very best at serving consumers with our familiar, everyday household and personal care brands. We're raising the bar on everything we do, especially when it comes to brand building. So today what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight for you a few of the things that we're doing. We're transforming media transparency for a clean and productive digital media supply chain. We're raising the bar on the quality of advertising and media content. We're leaping to the next disruption of mass one-to-one marketing. And we're using our reach and our voice in advertising as a force for good and a force for growth. And we realize that the actions that we're taking are not only good for P&G, they're good for the entire industry. Because if all of us in this room step up and collectively raise the bar, we can accelerate market growth. And that's good for all of us, especially consumers will also benefit. So today what I'll share with you, I'll share openly, and you can reapply whatever you want for your own business. Let's start with action one. We're transforming media transparency. The reason we're doing that is because of the huge waste in the murky, non-transparent, and in some cases, even fraudulent digital media supply chain. This is particularly in countries like the United States. In fact, this chart that we'll show you here is from the Association of National Advertisers in the United States, and it illustrates the problem. As little as 25% of the money that we invest in digital media actually makes it to the consumer. Now, at $200 billion and 21 years old, it was time for digital media to grow up. So together, we and other companies in this room are doing the following. These five key steps. We're adopting one viewability standard, so we know whether an ad has a chance to be seen. We're demanding third-party measurement verification, so we know we're getting the media reach that we pay for. We're demanding transparent agency contracts, so we know what our agencies are doing with our money. We're eliminating fraud, so we know humans see our ads, not robots. And we're ensuring brand safety, so we know our ads show up in the right place and not in objectionable content. Now, outside of China, we're about two-thirds of the way done today, and we should be largely finished by the end of 2017. I'm happy to say inside China, we're further along, as China has frankly been leading the way on building in a transparent media supply chain from the very start. But what we're doing here is a sea change in the digital media ecosystem around the world, and nearly everyone is doing their part. But we all must stay diligent and get this work done and then keep the standards high, because technology will continue to flourish. But these are common sense steps. They're long overdue, and they're absolutely necessary for a clean and productive media supply chain. Because we don't want to waste our money in this supply chain. Instead, we want to invest in what really matters, which is advertising and innovation to drive growth, which leads to action number two. We're raising the bar on advertising and media content quality. Transparency that I just talked about is foundational, but now that we have objective data, the real work begins to assess exactly what is the true quality of the investments that we're making. And as we've begun to do that, we've begun to find some things that were kind of illuminating, and we're demanding more. Let's take viewability, for example. And viewability is very simple. It's just, did a person have a chance to see the ad that we put out there? Now, for too long, Procter & Gamble was treating digital ads like any other form of television, flooding digital media with 30-second ads. But now that we have the data, we know that the average ad viewing time for many digital mediums is only 1.7 seconds, a blink of an eye. And in many cases, only 20% of people are watching a digital ad for more than 2 seconds, which is the minimum standard. That's kind of a wake-up call. Obviously, we've stopped wasting money on 30-second ads in this kind of medium, and we're figuring out how to, and actually are doing a great job, at using ads for 2 seconds. But what this did is cause us to ask a broader question. Why is it that consumers are only watching ads for 2 seconds? Well, think about it. In social media, what do you want to do? You want to talk to other people. You want to share your lives with other people. And let's face it, ads can be kind of annoying in that context. So, it's no wonder they only get a fleeting glance. And we know how to make a 2-second ad work, which we do, but surely we can do better than that. So what we've done is we've started to partner with many of our digital partners, including WeChat and Youku and many others, to innovate and create the next generation of digital ads. Because really, it's high time that we solve this problem together, collectively, to solve the problem of annoying digital ads and make the experience better for consumers. Let's move to verification. Once we started getting third-party data, we found that we were reaching too few people, too many times, with too many ads. Excess frequency is a massive source of waste in media. And yes, it really annoys consumers. This is Charmin, it's a toilet paper ad. How many times do you think a person needs to see a Charmin ad to really understand how it works? Not that many. It's no wonder ad blockers are growing at a 20% clip a year. Now, we're tackling annoying excess frequency with programmatic media buying, pioneered right here in China with companies and partners like ReachMax. So we can serve an ad to a consumer when they're receptive and cap the frequency so we don't keep serving it to them and annoying them. We're also working with our e-commerce partners, such as Alibaba and Jingdong, so we can precisely time an ad right when they have the highest propensity to buy, just before they're ready to buy. That not only helps us accelerate that purchase, it helps us accelerate our entire $1 billion e-commerce business, and it helps us cut waste by 20% and improve our return on investment by 4 times. But what's better is it's better for the consumer, a much better consumer experience. Now, what about fraud? Now, TAG is a trustworthy accountability group. That is something that we've done in the United States. And once we did it in the US, we stopped buying media from the long tail of websites. We were buying thousands of websites, which we found was a massive source of robots. And we believed, unfortunately, that there was this endless supply of media in these websites. And unfortunately, we proved that you get what you pay for, which is bot farms. These websites were a massive source of bots. So what we've done is we've cut off that long tail, and now we only work with the trusted and proven clean suppliers. So we cut off the bot-laden long tail. And let's talk about brand safety. Now in China, China's in great shape when it comes to brand safety, but this was a very unpleasant wake-up call in places like the US and the UK. We have zero tolerance in our company to have ads placed where there is violence or bigotry or hate. And to demonstrate our conviction, outside of China, that is, we cut $100 million of digital media, which was wasted digital media. And the reason why it was wasted is because we could not prove that it wasn't showing up on objectionable content. This proved to be a smart thing because we still delivered our sales growth objectives, which told us something, that this money was probably being wasted. So we needed to get a lot smarter about how we were spending our money. And we worked with the top players to get this cleaned up. But what was very interesting about the little timeout that we took is that it really caused us to step back and think about all of the content on which we advertise. How good is all of this quality? So there's no question that you don't want to advertise on a violent video or something that's objectionable. But really, how many cat videos should we be advertising on? And if you're watching a cat video, do you really want to see a toothpaste ad? So we began to just think, maybe we should shift this from brand safety to quality content. We started joining forces with partners like Tencent and Alibaba and other top media companies so we could identify the highest quality content on which to advertise. This is much better for consumers, and it's a lot better for our brands to be on this great content. And as media content elevates its game, that causes us to elevate our game in terms of great advertising. These huge audiences require our best work, and the payout can be enormous because you can reach millions and millions of hearts and minds with a great piece of advertising to drive growth. I want to show you these three ads from Pantene, Whisper, and Tide here from China, who are featuring some of our hot new products that are growing in double digits right here in this country. Here we go. So the wake-up call on media has been a loud one this year. We are raising the bar and transforming media transparency and innovating for the next generation of quality advertising and media content. And China's leading the way. So I would encourage you to accelerate the momentum, accelerate the innovation. It's good for our brands, and most important, it's good for China consumers. Action three, we're unleashing the next powerful brand building transformation, mass one-to-one marketing. Now, for more than a century, what brands have been doing is mass, blasting messages as far and as wide as we possibly can, hoping to catch someone's attention to get to buy one of our brands. This led to what was called the Wanamaker principle, which is half my advertising is wasted, I just don't know which half. Now, with consumer ID data, we're able to find out which half. And we're innovating with artificial intelligence and machine learning so we can reach people on a one-to-one scale, but at a mass scale with useful and engaging experiences. Let's take Pampers, for example. Who here has babies? Ooh, boy, young crowd, sorry. Well, you watch. As soon as a mom-to-be knows she's pregnant, who's the first to know? Google in the US, baby verticals in Pampa, in China. That's because she searches for pregnancy. Then it sends a signal to Pampers Club, who invites her to join the Pampers Club. From there, we answer questions about pregnancy using chat, AI, and machine learning. And at just the right time, because we know when she's most receptive, we send her an endearing ad like this. So from pregnancy to the day your baby leaves diapers, Pampers is going to be there for you every step of the way and giving you useful one-to-one engaging experiences. Okay, we're going to move to beauty. Who here uses skincare? You're lying. I know you use skincare. What's the number one problem in skincare? I can't find what's right for me. That's the number one problem. So we created what's called the Olay Skin Advisor. What this is a web app that uses big data and artificial intelligence to help people find the right product for their skin. What you do is you take a picture, and it's got a proprietary algorithm that feeds back into all sorts of big data and then determines your skin age, the age of your skin, compared to your actual age. I did it. It's a frightening experience. Okay, I was about 15 years older when I did that, and I was quite depressed afterwards, but that's okay. But anyway, what it does, though, is then it gives you personalized recommendations about how to take care of your skin and what kind of products that you use. Now, you know this, no one person's skin needs are the same, but this proprietary big data algorithm that we have is so good that 9 out of 10 women agree with the recommendations that they receive. So this is a personalized experience that uses AI to give may help you make the right purchase decision so you never leave the store without the right product. Okay, who here brushes their teeth? Okay, that's encouraging that most of you brush your teeth. Okay. Oral-B Genius is another example. What this is, Oral-B Genius, is a power toothbrush. It has a built-in sensor, so people can get the absolute best dental experience. Now, believe it or not, cavities are the number one preventable disease in the world. Gum disease, gum bleeding, is not far behind. And the reason why is that most people really don't know how to brush their teeth correctly. I know that seems surprising. And I mean, here's the deal. On average, people brush for 43 seconds, which is about 30 seconds more than I brush my teeth, versus the average 2 minutes that you're supposed to brush. If you're right-handed, you brush more on your left side. If you're left-handed, you brush more on your right side. And almost everyone brushes too hard, which creates gum bleeding and sometimes sensitive teeth. So what Oral-B does, this genius does, is it actually helps guide you throughout the entire brushing experience, so you brush with just the right pressure and just the right places. The average brushing time on Oral-B Genius is 2 minutes and 15 seconds versus the 43 seconds I told you before. And it has a red light that blinks whenever you brush too hard. My red light is always blazing when I'm brushing. So it helps you save your gums. So what this really is a personalized daily dental assistant that allows you to get the best absolute dental care. And it sends a signal to Oral-B so you can get a coupon or you know when to go buy it online when you're ready for a new brush. Now, we have a lot more examples, but we're just getting started. We have things like the SK2 Magic Ring Beauty Consultant. We've got Gillette On Demand. And we have experiments with a vast network of startups. Because what we've done in our company is we've unleashed this fast cycle innovation teams so we can accelerate to the next disruption of mass one-to-one marketing. And P&G is open for business. So bring us your best ideas and bring us your best talent. Action 4, using our voice in advertising as a force for good and a force for growth. We're transforming our brands and company into responsible citizens. And the reason why is because people today want to know what's behind a brand and who's behind a brand. What do they believe in? Who are the brand and people behind them in the company? What are their actions and points of view on the environment, diversity, ethics? And digital media and influencer marketing has enabled brand and companies to not only do well, but to also do good. These are some examples of advertising from several brands in different industries and in multiple countries. Now the question is, what do they have in common? It all touches hearts and opens minds. Some of it is beautiful, provocative, touching. And all of it is creative and responsible, promoting something that matters. These are brands and companies that are using their voices in advertising to take a stand and promote gender equality. Now, why gender equality? Well, the obvious reason is that women are half the world's population. It's just common sense that there should be complete equality between women and men, with equal voices, equal pay, and equal respect. But the reality is, it isn't equal. In fact, the World Economic Forum did a 2016 report and indicates that closing the gender gap on health, education, and economic participation has stalled. In fact, it's gone back to 2008 levels in many cases. That means that women and girls receive less health care than men. Girls drop out of school at a greater rate than boys. And women receive half as many STEM degrees as men. That leads to economic gaps. When they reach working age, 8 of 10 men have a paid job versus only 5 in 10 women. Girls spend 30% more of their time on jobs that pay nothing, zero. And there's the outrageous fact that women still get paid 20% less for the same job. All of this is unfair, of course. But imagine what an equal world could look like. McKinsey estimates that the economic impact of equal pay for equal work in the U.S. alone is worth $840 billion in additional wages and additional purchasing power, $28 trillion on a global basis. So in other words, equality is not only a force for good, it's a force for growth. So that's why we're using our reach and our voice in advertising to address important matters such as gender equality. By doing so, we can promote important conversations. We can influence attitudes, change biases and behaviors to help make the world a better place. And as I just mentioned, when the world is more equal, it leads to more growth. And in fact, what we've found is that our advertising that promotes gender equality actually performs better in driving growth and in changing attitudes. SK-II in China is one of our best examples and one of our pioneering examples. First of all, SK-II, which is a high-end skincare brand, which is an amazing skincare brand, is one of P&G's fastest growing brands. And what it does is it sparks conversations and changes attitudes. SK-II has a campaign idea called that is centered on the idea that women can change destiny. They can change the destiny of their skin, and they can change the destiny of their lives. SK-II has magnificent advertising, and they invite women into the brand with beautifully crafted human stories that attract women to its bold promise that they too can change destiny. I want you to watch this powerful film that takes on a deeply held norm about marriage.
Thank you.
I personally love that film. I have three daughters, 29, 26, 23, and all unmarried. But this film moved me and made me think about things a lot differently. And it sparked powerful conversations here in China. And it led to changing attitudes, as well as led to double-digit growth. And the great thing about SK2 is they didn't stop with this, which was brilliant in and of itself. They found another insight that broadened beyond China throughout Asia, that many women in Asia feel that they have an expiry date for the different stages of their life. And SK2 challenges that stereotype and encourages women to follow the I never expire credo. This campaign led to an ambitious scope because it featured China, Japan, and Korea stories, and in just one film. And it matched and even exceeded the buzz that came from the marriage market takeover. Now, this powerful advertising is changing attitudes about women. It's empowering women throughout Asia and encouraging women to change their own destiny. That's what gender equality is about. But we're going one step further, and I think we should all go one step further. Because imagine if every brand used their voice in advertising to be able to use their power to make a difference. Biases would shift. Attitudes would change. Action would be taken. Economic empowerment would improve and drive market growth. And that's why we've joined forces with these many industry coalitions to collaborate for good, shining a light on problems, opportunities, and solutions. These efforts inspire hundreds of companies to act together. There's no room for selfishness when it comes to the greater good. Now, we will all compete on the basis of innovation and creativity, but we've united behind one common brief to use our voices in advertising for good. And that's why at P&G, we invite everyone to come together for an equal and a better world. Thank you. So this year isn't complete yet, but it sounded a transformation wake-up call for the entire marketing world. So I'll close by asking you to do a few things. Complete transforming media transparency for a clean and productive media supply chain throughout the digital industry. Raise the bar on advertising and media content quality. Leap to the next disruption of mass one-to-one marketing. And step up to use your voices in advertising as a force for good and a force for growth. We're at a very exciting and important turning point. We're really completing one wave of transformation in traditional digital, and we're at the start of the next big brand building transformation. And China is leading the way. Let's unleash our tremendous innovative power that we have together for the consumers we serve. And let's usher in the greater good for the communities in which we live and drive growth for the markets in which we operate. I'm very much looking forward to accelerating the momentum with you on this amazing journey. Thank you. CSA.
Thank you very much, Mark. And while we have 4 minutes left, we'd like to open the floor for questions from the audience. We've also received, okay.
4 minutes.
The brave one.
The brave one.
Hi, Mark.
Hi.
This is Leon from iQIYI, which is not shown on your logo table.
I took that feedback and it will be there next time.
This is not direct feedback. Actually, I love those advertisements that you have shown to us. Those are very content-driven advertisements, and which is very provocative and very touching. However, could you please elaborate more about how you evaluate the influence and the effectiveness, especially in psychologically perspective?
Absolutely, it's a great question. I tell you, the way we think about advertising is actually broader than what I just showed you. We think about it as painting a masterpiece across a creative canvas. So think about your brand being a masterpiece. You have about 80% of that is advertising that focuses on the product and what the product does, describes its effectiveness. Those ads that I showed you, the Whisper ad with the cotton, the Tide Pods ad is another good example, even the Pantene ad, really focuses on why the product is better and why it's superior. Then what we like is we like to have about 20% of our advertising that really just touches the heart, that expresses a point of view about what the brand stands for, like Whisper, like a girl, like SK2, Marriage Market Takeover. What that does is you actually spend very little money on that. Those ads spend a fraction of our paid media, but because of influencers, key opinion leaders, and power of digital media and the power of chat, people talk about them, and they actually get a disproportionate amount of awareness. So we do advertising where we evaluate literally how your brain reacts to it. We have something called neurotesting, where you test the brain and see how it reacts, and we've compared that to the effectiveness in market. But one thing I would also suggest is when you look at advertising, how does it touch you? If you feel like it's a great ad, then it'll touch you. I know my test is my spine tingles. I get a little spine tingle. Then I know that that's a great ad. So it's a great question. Thank you for asking.
Thank you. And for that, we have a Braun 5 series. It's our latest Braun, and it moves like a four-wheel drive on your face, supposedly, and it will detect the different contours of your face. So the
Excellent.
Braun 5.
There you go. Braun,
the Braun 5,
5
series.
There you go.
Okay, another question. Any question? Okay.
Hi, Mark. This is Elaine from China, Chinese social media, Weibo, and I didn't see our logo over there.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Didn't take note of that as well.
Oh, no. We'll take care of that.
Yeah, thank you. I love those ads, and I love P&G too. I have one question for you. You know this festival is called ROI. So what's your, from a P&G point of view, is there any single factor of media performance you care most?
What we care about on media?
Yeah.
One, does it reach the people we're seeking? We really look at reach because our brands and products are everyday household and personal care products. They're people washing your hair, brushing your teeth, doing your laundry. You want to reach a lot of people. We want to reach them, though, not too often. That's why I talked about frequency. We want to reach them. Our friend Yabin He is here, who has been masterful at helping us figure out how to reduce excess frequency. But then what we have to do is combine that with a great ad that is high quality, that engages the heart and the mind. And when those three things come together, we generate sales. Hence, return on investment, ROI, China ROI Festival. That's why we're here.
Thank you.
And then for that, you get an Oral-B brush, a power brush that we just talked about.
Hopefully it's a genius brush.
Okay.
Remember, don't brush too hard.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay.
Here's right here.
Good evening,
sir. Your last question. Sorry.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm so lucky. So I'm Chris from MBA. And we all know, oh, by the way, thank you so much for the mind-blowingly amazing speech just now. And we all know P&G is a leading company in terms of brand management. So my question is, would you please briefly share with us what do you think is the key to successful brand management?
Aha. Uh-huh.
Thanks. If you're allowed to disclose that.
Of course.
Sure.
The key to successful brand management. The first thing to do is to know your consumer better than anybody on the planet. It's so important. Understand what your consumer wants, needs, how he or she feels, what their lives are like, how they shop, everything. Number two, know your brand better than anybody. Know your entire history. Every brand I get on, I go back to the day that brand was born, and I look at everything that happened throughout its entire life. Because what that does is helps you understand the brand's personality and essentially its DNA. And the third thing I would say is focus on you as an individual of being useful. Be useful to others. Focus outwardly. If you focus on being useful to others, whether it be consumer or your teammates, then you will be far more effective and you'll be far happier as well. And you'll be a lot more productive. Consumers, brands, useful to others, the three things that I would offer you.
Thank you very much. I'll hammer them in my mind.
Okay, the bell just rang. And with that we call it a wrap. Once again, a big round
of
applause for Marc Pritchard.
Thank you.
And let's all go forth and become forces of good and forces for growth. Thank you very much.
Okay. Did he?
Yes. Okay.
Thanks again to all our speakers this day. We have a wonderful time together. We have a wonderful summit. For today, our summit is over. See you tomorrow, 8:30 in the morning. Xixie dajia, mingtian wo men zai padian pan zai kaishi. Xixie.